You are your way. supply all my needs. You are Jireh. You meet all my needs. I lack nothing. You are Jireh. Alpha and Omega. That is who you are. You are Jireh. To that person on the sick bed, he is Rapha, the Lord your healer. Yes, God. He is Rapha, and he's healing your body right now. Oh, you are Rapha, Alpha and Omega. Oh, we bless you, God. You are Alpha, Alpha, and Omega. I'll tell you what health is. He is Shalom. He is my peace. It doesn't matter what the storm looks like. It doesn't matter what the situation looks like. It doesn't matter what it feels like. He is Shalom, and he is my peace. He is your peace. He is your peace. Ooh. You are Yahweh, Alpha and Omega. Yeah. Oh Lord, you are Yahweh. Oh, you are Alpha and Omega. So you are Yahweh.
It's Christmas morning. We want to greet the saints in the name of the Lord and wish everyone a Merry Christmas, and also want to encourage everyone who may be spending time, spending Christmas this year for the first time away from their families and not being able to enjoy Christmas with a large gathering. And we also subscribe and respect what the governments and the ministries of health are telling us. This morning I want us to speak about a man who was more than a man. Our Christmas message this morning. Before we go into the message, I want us to go into a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the significance, Lord, of Christmas. We know that this season signifies a very important occurrence in the body of Christ and in the Christendom. We thank you, Lord, that you are going to allow us to be able to explain and share your word concerning your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, that you are going to open the eyes and the minds of your people. They are going to be able to receive your word, and your word is going to work in our lives and change us and change the way we think and the way we perceive God and the way we perceive our Christian relationship with you. Thank you, Lord, that you are King and there's no other one like you. Even as we share this word this morning, we believe, God, you are going to actively use it to change and to shift our perspectives. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. So I want to start, first of all, by explaining to the church, and I know we've done this over and over again, to translate and even speak about the fact that if you look at the calendar of the scriptures or the original text, finding out when Jesus was born, we know that he wasn't born on the 25th of December. But we are doing this so that we can be able to bring counsel to the body of Christ and also be able to explain what is the significance of his birth. Now, I spoke a couple of years ago, I think it must have been 2 years ago, where I was speaking about the birth of Jesus. And I explained to the church that when we speak about the birth of Jesus, we are speaking of a very significant occurrence in the body and in the larger scheme of things, that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit and was born of the Virgin Mary. And every time we speak about this, people ask, because we are now educated and we understand biology, we also understand anatomical issues, we ask ourselves, how is it possible that a woman who is a virgin can conceive, and not just conceive, but conceive through the Holy Spirit? Now, Jesus, as I would explain as I go on, had no earthly or human father, but was conceived by the Holy Spirit, which means the Holy Spirit or God borrowed the carcass or borrowed the body of Jesus to carry the Christ through Mary. It then declares that he was indeed born, but born by a woman. The name was Mary, who never before had intimate relationships with a man. That's why she's called the Virgin Mary. And if you read the story, you will find out that she had a visitation by the Holy Spirit or through an angel. And the angel explained explicitly that she was going to conceive and she was going to give birth to a son. And the son was going to be called Jesus. And she asked a very fundamental question on how this was going to be, because she was a virgin. And she spoke passionately about that. And the angel of the Lord spoke something very interesting. He said, "And the Holy Spirit shall overshadow you." And then she agreed and said, "Let it be according to the will of God over my life." And that is one of the things that blows the minds of people every time they read the story, because we get to a point where we are so open-minded and so educated that we scrutinize every bit of it. So I'm going to attempt this morning to explain. This says three important things, indeed absolutely essential things about Jesus the Christ. The first one, it says that he is God, because his conception was absolutely and uniquely divine. And secondly, it says that Jesus is a man because he was born of the Virgin Mary, just like any baby is born. Though his conception was absolutely unique, that his birth was like of any other baby because of the way that she arrived, the way that he arrived. And this is very interesting, because every time I speak about it, I also get some divine expositions and revelations about it. Third, it refers to a great truth theologians have called the incarnation. It refers to the event and the phenomenon of God becoming a man. The New Testament teaches over and over again that Jesus is born fully God and fully man. You can read John chapter 1. You can read Romans chapter 1. You can read Galatians 4 and 4. You can read Philippians chapter number 2 and 1 Timothy 3 and 16 to further dig deeper in trying to understand what it is. So as I was praying and preparing to speak about this, I said to myself, when Jesus was born and born out of a virgin, it absolutely means that his birth itself was unique. It has had never been seen before. Never had a woman given birth through the conception of the Holy Spirit. But it also signified what was going to happen in the future, because we are calling ourselves born again. But we are born, but we don't go back to the tummies or the bellies of our mothers, but we claim to be born again. So that phenomena is a phenomenon that you cannot explain using words of men, but it can only but arrive through an intervention of God and the Holy Spirit. So the incarnation and what it means. The fact of the incarnation is clearly stated, but the meaning of the incarnation is also important to understand. First, we need to explain, we should understand what it is not. Because everyone speaks about incarnation, but no one really bothers to explain what it means. It isn't that Jesus is part man and part God, but it says he is fully man and fully God. It isn't that Jesus was God on the inside and human on the outside. Now, I will further explain so that we can get the clarity, because when you speak about the birth of Jesus and we speak about celebrating the birth of Jesus, we really get confused and don't know what it is and what it means. Number two, it isn't that Jesus was only human in his flesh and only God in his spirit. And we need to further explain that the incarnation is not subtraction, but it is addition. Jesus did not empty himself of the divine nature and any divine attribute, but he only emptied himself of his status of equality with the Father, taking a subordinate position by an act of his will. You will see that in the book of Philippians, chapter number 2, verse 5 to 8. Very, very importantly, he didn't need to empty himself. But what he needed to do, he needed to relegate himself to become a human being like us and live on earth and actually feel what we feel on earth and take a subordinate position by an act of his will. Which means when God said he wanted to send his son, he had to agree to go down on earth and be able to bring in what we call salvation today. Though Jesus could let go of his status, but he could never stop being God. So it then becomes interesting that when he was living on earth, he was not half-half, but he was 100%, 100%. And he is God, and he lives, and he lived and exuded the elements of God. The glory and the divine of God was locked up in him. And in every area of his life, he was able to demonstrate who he is by performing miracles and demonstrating that even though he was walking on earth, he was able to do what no other man or no other person could do because he was God. Some have taught that Jesus lost his deity when taking our sin on the cross. But if Jesus could ever stop being God, he could never even been, he could never have been God in the beginning, from the beginning. Some actually argue and say, but how is that possible in human nature? And I've always said, if it was possible or common, or we were able to explain it in human words, then it would mean that he is actually not God. Because if he were born the very same way like us and exhibited the very same characters and characteristics, then it would mean that he is just one of the common men and looks like us. So what is incarnation? It is when the eternal Son of God, the second person of the Holy Trinity, added humanity to his diet. And every time I speak about this, people say, but why are you saying God is in three parts? I always ask, why are we saying we human beings are in three parts? Because it is easy for us as people to understand the deity, because we are also in three parts. We are living in a body, we are spirit, and we have a soul. So we've got three parts. So when the eternal Son of God, the second person of the Holy Trinity, added an element of humanity to his deity, then that is what is called incarnation. Now, he never became less of God, but he added a human nature to his divine nature, and so became one person with distinct natures functioning together in perfect harmony. I was explaining to my son the other day, he was asking me the very same question. A 10-year-old young man was asking me, explain to me what it means to live in Trinity. I explained to him that you are living in a body, and you have a spirit, and you have a soul. And I told him that if your soul will be affected and you would have a mental health disorder or a psychiatric disorder, it then renders you a human being, but incomplete, because one of the elements that make you is not functioning properly. Or if you were to have a body dying, then your spirit will not have a place of residence, so you will pass away and your spirit will go because it doesn't have a place to live. So it's important for us to understand what it is. He never became less of God, but he added a human nature to his divine nature, and so became one person with two distinct functions, functioning together in perfect harmony. It sounds strange to you as you are listening, and also when I was reading, and I've been reading this for the past 20 years, it still is confusing, but very mesmerizing and very mysterious, and which makes me every day to want to dig and try and understand, why did Jesus have to come? Why was he on earth? And why are we saying he was God when he was on earth? Now, consider that in a sense, every human being is one person with two natures, each inherited from their parents. And every child is fully the son or daughter of each parent. Now, I know in Eswatini, they then say, hey, ufute unina, because it looks like the mother. Or they say, ufute his father, because he acts like the dad. We should also remember that humanity that Jesus added to his divine nature was not the sinful humanity we commonly know, but the perfect humanity which was exhibited in the Garden of Eden by Adam and Eve. The perfect humanity, the type in which we are supposed to live on earth today after we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and personal Savior. So which means his birth was to salvage, was to rescue us from the place of sin and then restore us to our original state, which we were in the Garden of Eden before sin came. So are you saying it is possible for me to be perfect? Yes, I'm saying it is definitely possible according to the scriptures and according to God. God, when he made us perfect human beings. He made us in such a way that we could dominate on earth by exercising every authority that God gave to us. So we are not just mere people on earth trying to exist and fumbling in the dark trying to find where to go. We already have a mandate by virtue of our birth. That's why Jeremiah says, when he prophesies, he says, God says to him, I knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb, and I called you by name. Now, when the Bible says, I called you by name, it doesn't mean he called him Clement Dlamini, pastor of Let's Go to Glory Worship Center. But God defined the mandate of Jeremiah before he was born. And then when he translates it, he says, there are people that are going to frown at you as you deliver your mandate. He says, don't worry about the frowns on their faces, because that will derail you. It will make you think that you are at the level of where they are. But you are beyond any criticism. You are beyond any ridicule. You are beyond any type of infighting and malicious discussions about your life. You are here as a carrier, or someone who carries the mandate of God, the anointing of God, the glory of God to change the nations. And this makes me get excited, because if you look at your own human nature and wonder how it could ever be joined with divine nature, remember that Jesus's humanity was certainly more compatible with deity than ours. And when you look at that fact, you ask yourself, what is it that was said to Jesus when he was born? What is the message that God gave to Mary and Joseph when Jesus was born? He said, he's going to be the Savior. He's coming in to save the world. He's going to be the catalyst for salvation. He will restore men back to their position. And that could only have been done, not just by being born, but it had to be done by dying. For him to be able to complete the equation, he needed to be born. He needed to live and exercise authority amongst us and mingle with men and dwell with Pharisees and dwell with also people who were called prostitutes and those who were not allowed or who were not recognized on earth, and heal a woman who had an issue of blood for 12 years, who was dirty, came into the crowd, touched the hem of his garment, and Jesus did not ridicule him. When you read the scriptures, they don't even mention her name. They say there was a woman with an issue of blood. But after Jesus healed the woman and the blood flow ceased, he said, "Daughter, go your way and your sins are forgiven." Which means the woman came as a woman with no name and left Jesus as a daughter. So it's important for us to understand, why was he on earth? He was not here just to demonstrate that he can live on earth as a God, but he was here to show us that we could live as human beings on earth carrying God and be able to fulfill the mandate of God and be able to restore people back to their original state. So our duty as Christians, our duty as those who receive him and those who accept him into their lives, is for us to be able to restore parity, to restore the order of things on earth. The Bible says nature is groaning with groanings that cannot be uttered, waiting for the revelations of the sons of God. And if the sons are not revealed, the world or the order of the world will not be in the right place. But if we receive Christ and we receive the mandate and understand why we are here, order is going to be restored. What am I saying? I'm saying nature will bow to you because you are restored to your position. Where do you take that from, Fundis? Let me explain. The Bible says when God, after God created everything, he left it at the hands of the man, the humus man, the Adamu. He said to him, take care of it. Make sure that it is replenished. You use it up, it replenishes itself. It restores itself back. He says to him, name the animals. Let them come in front of you. Give them the names. And the Bible says those animals, even today, those are their names. So the authority and dominion belongs to man. God did not rule on earth, but God ruled on earth by extension, which is through the human being or the man or the woman that he created and said, let us make men in our own image and our own likeness, which means God said, I want to make something that looks like me, which will exist on earth. And I want to create someone who actually acts like me, which means it's the Bible says he make him in our own image and likeness. Likeness means I do things like him. So God allowed that, but sin came and disrupted all of these things. And someone is asking, but why would God allow sin? God allowed sin because does not tamper with the will of the human being. He allows them to exist on earth, to function completely as human beings, carrying the mandate of God. But men faltered and sinned. And Jesus came to then restore that parity, take us back to our original state. So when he came for everyone. Christmas is by extension, meaning that he was born so that you can be restored. He was born so that you can go back to your original state. Right now we struggle with sickness. We struggle with disease. We struggle with poverty and squalor. We struggle with lack. When the Bible says for everything that we needed to exist and to blossom or to get the fruits that was necessary, we were given the land and everything that God had created. And we are struggling, allowing people to come and take from what God has given to us and go and produce it or reproduce it and sell it back to us, even though we've got every resource at our disposal. Jesus had come to restore that very same thing. We are the people of God, given the authority by God to be able to function and exist on earth and be able to influence generations so they can know who God is. That's why the Bible says the earth is the Lord's and its fullness thereof. It says in Siswat, umhlaba unga Jehova, live na labakhile labakhekulo, which means everything that is on earth belongs to God and by extension belongs to us. We are the people of God who are custodians of every resource that God has given to us. So Jesus came to restore that. It says, I want to read it again. It says, if you look at your own human nature and wonder how it could ever be joined with divine nature, Remember that Jesus' humanity was certainly more compatible with diet than ours. Actually, we are supernatural beings. Our natural state is supernatural. It is not just natural in terms of the naturality that has been defined by people. They are saying it's natural for us to be born and not live with our fathers. They are saying it's natural. They are saying it's natural for us to be left and unloved. They say that's natural. But that is not natural. The order of God is not that. The order of God is that humanity must exist in its full potential and be able to exercise the liberty of God and do what God wants to be done. Now, we need to remember that Jesus remains incarnated eternally. If you look at Acts chapter number 7, verse 55 and 56, or 1 Timothy chapter number 2 and verse 5, he did not relinquish his human nature when he ascended into heaven. Now, you will have to read this in depth because it is Christmas morning and we have only a few minutes to explain. But it is very, very interesting to understand that he did not lose who he was in terms of human nature when he left for the heavens. Now, he is still fully God, existing in the heavens. And when he sits in the heavens, he sits with a concern concerning the earth. He sits at the right hand of the Father, and he sits in the heavens and is concerned about the issues that are happening on earth. But a man in a resurrected body, he became a man in a resurrected body, as we will one day have. Because when we go back to the Father, we are going to go back to the Father in a resurrected body. Now, it is important for us to understand that when we struggle, let's not just focus on the fact that we are struggling, but let's focus and draw from this element in us, the godly element in us, or the supernatural element in us, which was provoked by the coming of Christ, which is our original state. Now, why is it important? Because if Jesus were not fully man, he could not be a substitute for the punishment that man deserves. So which means when he was lying on the cross on his death, he didn't carry the cross as God. He carried the cross as a human man, or as a human man. He carried the cross as a man. So when they were hitting him with the nails and piercing him on the side, he felt the pain as a human being would feel it. When they put the crown of thorns on his head, he didn't carry the crown as God. He carried the crown as man. So we need to understand that his being fully man is very, very exciting. It shows that we can be able to exist and be able to function in the space of the world or the earth and function fully as men and fully as people that look like God or people that are God. I was preaching last weekend and I said, a dog cannot give birth to a chicken. A dog will give birth to a dog. So it is when we are born of God, then it means we carry God in us. We are actually the representation of who God is. We are the image of the invisible God. So which means we exist on earth, and that's what it means for Jesus to die. And if he were not fully God, his sacrifice would have never been enough. If Jesus is not fully God and fully man, we are lost in sin. So he demonstrated. That's why the Hebrews will say we do not have a high priest who is detached, I am paraphrasing, from our pains, which means he understood what pain is. He understood what rejection is. The very same people who were saying, Lord, 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 are the very same people when he went to the cross who deserted him. He understood what it was. So if you are thinking that because you were deserted, you are better, you are a better Christian because you were deserted, Jesus was deserted. He was rejected. He was rejected in his own town. When he came to try and preach, no one received him because he was in his city. They knew him as the son of the carpenter. So don't ever think that because you are rejected, you are a special kind. Jesus was rejected. So it then makes me understand that when the birth of Jesus was given to us, it was given to us so we could be restored to remain on earth as fully God and fully man. And I know people will say, oh, that's heretic, Mfundisi. What is that? It doesn't mean anything. But it's important for us to understand. Because the moment you discover who you are in the larger scheme of things, you are unbeatable. You are undefeated. You are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus, your Lord. Why? Because you have understood your position. The challenge we have is when Jesus came and died and died on the cross, or when he was born, he ushered in a new era where now men can be able to live on earth and live together as God. And not just live together as God, and also have an extension who is Jesus, who will remain their mediator and sit in the heavens and pray for them. Read John 17. You will see that when he prays for us, he says, I don't want you to take them away from earth. I want you to empower them whilst they are living on earth. Give them the power, the very same power that you had given to me, for so they can be able to exist, which shows that we can actually fully function on earth as he did function. Now, the incarnation says that man really is made in the image of God. We know this in Genesis 1 and 26. And that perfect humanity is more compatible with deity than we usually imagine. We are saying for your perfection to be completed, you need to have received Jesus Christ and accepted him as your personal Lord and Savior. He is the one that makes you to become who you are supposed to become. And I know this narrative is always rejected by people and saying, but you guys look like us, you do things like us, you act like us. It is only that we are evolving. We are going to get to a place where we are going to be perfected and be able to become and to do things the way God does things. The Apostle Paul speaks and says, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. And when he says all things, it means literally all things. It literally means you can do all things. But the challenge we have is, every time we are faced with all things, we then coil back and say, I'm a human being. But the challenge is, it seems like we are demeaning or relegating our lordship or our godship or the glory of God that's in us. We are actually relegating that we look like God. We are relegating the fact that we actually can do things like God. I mean, how many of us have been in positions where there was no solution, there was an impasse in a meeting, or there was a crisis that was being, and everyone was scratching their heads and they didn't know what to do. But you as a child of God said, Lord, give me words to say, or give me direction, and boom, a direction came. And that direction is not coming because you are educated. It's not coming because you read a lot of books, but it comes as an urgent message that drops into your spirit. And that can only happen if you are using and exercising your Godship. You are exercising the authority that has been given to you by God. You are not acting out of human nature, but you are acting out of Godship. So it's important for us to understand that the incarnation says that our problem is not our humanity, but it is our fallenness. To say I am only human is wrong, because Jesus was fully human and yet he was perfect. And the challenge in the body of everywhere in the world, we are quick to say, I struggle because I am human, and forget that there is another part of us that is of God. The birth of Jesus is the very same thing that makes us who we are. It is more accurate to say, I am fallen if you are struggling. And I know, judgment. People are saying, he's judging us. But the challenge that we're having is fallenness. The moment I do not remember that when I'm struggling, I should go to the place of the presence of God, I am fallen. When things happen and I start pointing fingers at others, I should know I'm fallen. It has nothing to do with people. It has everything to do with you. You have moved away from your position. You need to stay in that position. If you are a child of God, you need to embrace that he is God over everything that concerns you. Now, I'm coming towards a close on Christmas morning. They're saying, that's a hard message for Christmas. She was speaking about birthday presents. Well, I can speak about presents. It's Jesus' birthday, but all the presents are coming to you. If it was his birthday, all of them will be going to Jesus. We could understand why man will want to be God, but we cannot understand why God will want to be man. That's the mystery. Why would God leave everything that's nice, the way we explain heaven, and come and want to be man? He needed to understand our struggles, understand our weaknesses, understand and actually prove to us that we can be able to exercise and live on this earth and demonstrate full Godship, if there's anything like that, or godliness. Demonstrate godliness and live on earth and be able to demonstrate who God is on earth. He had to be a man. He had to feel pain, because he knew you were going to feel pain. He had to weep when his friend died, because he showed his human nature. Now, what does it say to you? It says you can also embrace godliness. You can live and exercise full godliness in your life. And now are you saying, what are you saying? Are you saying, I'm saying, yes, I'm saying, you can be able to become God on earth. When we sing songs that he is Lord of Lords, we're not speaking about lords that are coming from England. We are speaking about lords being us living on earth in our dominion. When we speak about gods on earth, we are speaking about us. We have been made a little lower than Elohim. We can exist, we can demonstrate, we can show forth the glory of God. So the incarnation means there is a God in heaven who knows what we go through. Not only in theory, but in actual practice, he knows. So when you struggle with your relationship with God, when you struggle with your dad, when you struggle with your mom, when you struggle with pain or squalor or poverty, you must understand that Jesus, the very same God that seated on the right hand of the Father, he knows. He is close to your infirmities. He understands what it is. And it means that God does not ask of us what he has not done himself. Now, people are saying, did he struggle with a sin? Did he struggle with what we are struggling with? He did. One day they brought a woman who was found in adultery. And if they find you in adultery, they were supposed to stone you. They don't dress you up first, but they bring you as you are. They said they found her in action, and they pulled her up and brought him to Jesus. What does Jesus do? He kneels on the ground and he writes on the ground. And he says, he who has no sin, let him cast the first stone. And none of them cast a stone, and they left one by one. He lifted up his face and he said, where are your accusers? And they all left. And he also said, I don't accuse you. Go. What am I saying? I'm saying he is in touch with our infirmities. When he died on the cross, when they were eating, he wasn't smiling. He wasn't celebrating and saying, I don't feel pain. The man felt pain. When he was about to go to the cross, he prayed until blood came out of his eyes. And he actually even made a prayer. If it is possible, let this cup pass away from me. But then he said, let not my will but your will be done. He struggled. When humanity or human nature came on him, he remembered that he had to subscribe to the will of God. What am I saying? I'm saying Jesus came, died, came, he was born, and then he died. But today we are speaking about his birth. His birth means you can also be born. You can also know God. You can also function where God wants to function. I want us to pray. Father, thank you for the birth. Today we are commemorating and remembering the birth of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you came. You did what you were supposed to do. You completed your assignment. You never returned to God void, without accomplishing what he had sent you out to do. And we believe the same, God. We can be able to do exactly what you have sent us to do on earth. We'll be able to fulfill our mandate. We are going to be able to fulfill what you sent us on earth to do. And I pray even this person that is watching this morning and may not know Jesus as his personal Lord and Savior or her personal Lord and Savior, Father, rescue them. Arrest every spirit that is contrary, fighting, disagree. Convict them with your spirit that they may know you as God. And remember that you were born, and when you were born for us, to save us, to restore us to our original position. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen.